Good morning. Welcome to the first Sunday of August. Happy to have you here. We begin with a call to worship. I will tell my brothers and sisters about you. I will praise you in a public meeting. Praise the Lord, all you who respect him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. Fear him, all you Israelites. He does not ignore those in trouble. He doesn't hide from them, but listens when they call out to him. Lord, I praise you in the great meeting of your people. These worshipers will see me do what I promised. And this comes from Psalm 22, verses 23 to 25.
Thank you.
Church, helping us to be able to see our church's vision as we continue to move forward and do all the things that we've called to do. Most importantly, Lord, we thank you for letting us be able to see you spiritually, emotionally, any way that we can, Lord. We're thankful that we can see you and be part of your kingdom, because where would we be if it wasn't for you? Thank you, Lord, for this amazing congregation of Montgomery Hills Baptist Church. Blessings each and every person represented, whether member, visitor, friend, family, or other. There's so many blessings each person brings to our congregation, Lord. We just want to lift each person up. I'm not going to call out the names because it's too many to count. But thank you for each and every person that calls Montgomery Hills their home or their visiting place. We love them, Lord, and we love you. And as we love you, Lord, we also want to continue to pray the words you've taught us in the Lord's Prayer, as we say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
We welcome you to our worship service here at Montgomery Hills Baptist Church. If you're in the sanctuary, we're so glad you're here. It makes us not feel quite so lonely, right? See you all here. And of course, I love to hear you sing together and just love the fellowship of having you here. If you're at home, we're glad you're here too. Join us in person or on Zoom. Let's just all worship together our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Just want to mention a couple of things for the week. August is Family Month here at Montgomery Hills. There are activities for youth, and I see some of our youth right here on the second row. I'm so glad to see them. And those of you who are at home, parents, please take note of the newsletter this month because it details some exciting activities. One of the big things I want to highlight is this Friday night is teen game night. We'll have basketball goal, ping pong table, badminton set, anything, and other table games and things. We're going to have a great time here Friday night. So I hope you guys will come and get your friends to come, and maybe I'll show you how to do a hook shot. Or are you laughing? I'll tell you a story about my hook shot these days. Anyway, we're going to have a great time, and I hope that you'll come. I put something on Facebook yesterday. I need help today. I've got the basketball goal in the back of my car, so my car is sitting like this. And I appreciate it if some of you would help get it out of the car after church today, bring it to Fellowship Hall. Then I need people to put the things together. Ping pong table's in the hall, still in the box. The basketball goal is still in the box. So I need help, please. So that's Friday. Sunday afternoon after church, the children go to duck pin bowl. So we're going to, well, duck pin bowl are small balls with short pins. We'll have a great time together. So come bring your friends. And one more thing I want to highlight. The date is August 13th is family movie night. And you don't have to have a child to come. Anybody's welcome to come. We're going to see the movie Doolittle with Robert Downey Jr. It's a fun movie, and we'll show up to Fellowship Hall, have snacks, have a great time together. So take a look at the newsletter, put it on your calendar, and everybody come and let's play. It's been too long since we played, huh? Too long. Too much sadness, too much bad news. We're going to play, so let's do that this month. Take note that the Monday night and Wednesday night Bible studies will continue in September. So if you were planning to start this week, call me. I'll have a Bible study with you on the phone. But we're going to wait until September to start those up again, so watch for those. We will be having prayer every Thursday night during the month of August. I believe those are the only announcements that I have. Anything else from anyone? Then it's time for our offering. Would the ushers please come forward to receive the offering? Wow, front row, I wasn't expecting that. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for allowing us to be here today, for helping us, for waking us, bringing us into your house to be with other people who love you too. We thank you that you have given us gifts, Lord, physical gifts, monetary gifts, that we can give back to you this morning at this time. So take these gifts that we have, they're yours. Use them for your kingdom, for bringing souls to you, for changing lives, Lord, they're yours. In Jesus' name. Break down the bread of life, Lord, to you. Let's sing.
Today's scripture comes from John chapter 6, verses 24 through 20. I'm sorry, John chapter 6, verses 24 through 35. If I have it correct, it's on page 867 in the Pew Bibles. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went into Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom was sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." May the Lord have a blessing to his holy word.
Would you join me as we go to the word of prayer? Gracious God, thank you for the gift of another day, of all the things that we take for granted, and there are many. Just the gift of being given one more day often passes us by. We've come from so many different places. We have experienced so many different things in this week since we last gathered. And yet you have been with us in each one of those experiences and each moment and each step. And we're grateful, for it is your presence that has brought us here today, that has enabled us to come through this time and together now to worship you. We bring what we have to offer. We ask only that you would help us to truly make ourselves available for your presence and for your speaking to us. May your spirit within us connect profoundly with you and bring us into communion as we gather around this table. Take these moments that we spend together, fill them full with your presence, open our lives to that presence. For we ask it in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Well, we left last week, those of you that were here, and hopefully you remember that we left the feeding of the 5,000. And at the end of that passage, there was this brief statement. We didn't focus on that last week. Sort of the transition to the text this morning. But Jesus noted that at the conclusion of the feeding of these 5,000 people, that he perceived that the people wanted to take him and make him a king by force. And because of that, he left. And he went back up the mountain, which is why he came over to that side of the Galilee in the first place. remember, beginning of that story is that he wants to get away from the crowd on the western shore. So he came to the eastern shore, he gets over there, the crowd followed him. And he had to deal with the hunger and the need, but all of that, which he did. So at the end of that time, Jesus went back up into the mountain to be by himself. The disciples, I assume, were waiting around with the crowd, and Jesus didn't come back. It was getting dark, so they got in a boat, and they started to go back to the western shore of the Sea of Galilee. I've lost count now how many trips we made back and forth together across the Sea of Galilee, but it's a lot. It almost seems as though Jesus is always traveling back and forth over the Sea of Galilee. And over these last weeks, he certainly hasn't been doing that. This is the occasion, by the way, that when they're out after dark that night, that the disciples see Jesus coming walking on the water. And it's after dark, and they're terrified, they think it's a ghost. Nothing beyond that really happens. Scripture said that they were going to ask him to get in the boat, but he disappeared, and then they came to the shore shortly after that. So he finally arrived back on the western shore, and that's where the text picks up this morning. When they found him on the other side, now who is they? The crowds. Everywhere he was going, they followed him. Every trip across the sea, they followed him. And they've done it again. So he gets back on the western shore, and there the crowds are again. And they said, Rabbi, when did you come here? What's with that question? I don't know. I guess they really want to know why left them on the other side as he did, but why did you come there? They wanted them. And Jesus said, well, forget about why I came here. Why did you come here? And I will tell you the reason you came here. You came here because I fed you. You came here because back on that other side, you saw something happen that amazed you. And you got some food. And you like that. And you're looking for more of the same thing. Jesus says, just like your fathers, for whom God provided the manna when they were wandering in the wilderness, you all heard the story of the manna that was on the ground every morning, and they could collect it, but it didn't last. And they had to go through the process every day. Just like their fathers who longed for the manna that did not last and told centuries later stories about the manna and how wonderful it was. It was sweet to taste, it satisfied an immediate hunger, but it didn't last. It had to be gathered up every morning or it would disappear again. Now, I don't think that we're too far removed from those. I think we're impressed by flashy things. I think we're impressed by big stuff and things we can't understand and miracles that seem to take place. So many today are seemingly only able to see the spiritual blame, the things that shine, the things that catch their attention. They can't see the simple things, the basic things. They don't come with bling attached to them. They don't come with lights flashing. They don't come gathering attention and pointing to themselves. Allow dynamic displays of power and wonders that wow us. Crowds that gather with us and affirm our own feelings. We must be right. Look at all the folks that are here with us. All 5,000 gathered around here. Wonderful. Must be right. that traction, that blank, that whatever it is, like any other addiction, as time goes on, it takes you more and more to satisfy the moment, to satisfy the addiction. Which means that if that's what is drawing people, you got to keep topping yourself. You got to keep coming up with something new, something blingier. I don't know if that's a word, but you understand what I'm saying. Something that's even more impressive, bigger, louder, so that the crowds continue to be expressed by those things. And when that becomes the focus, what gets lost is the simple, basic things that God offers to us. So, this is what Jesus is telling the crowds. It's only the true bread from heaven that gives life to the world, he says. The man was not that bread. And they respond by saying, true bread from heaven that gives life. We want some of that. That's even bigger than what we saw happen on here. On the other side, or the healings that we've seen. Give us this bread always, they respond. But like so many things in the spiritual life, it isn't what we think it is. It isn't what they thought it was. It was something profoundly simple and deep. It's not another awe-inducing wonder that they love to see. It's instead the one who stands right before them. The person, the individual. I am the bread. I am the bread of life. And if you don't get that, if you don't see that, if you don't understand that, if you're not able to draw from that, all the blank in the world will leave you hungry. But Jesus says that whoever believes in me will never again be hungry or thirsty. That's critical to understand something about the word believe. In the New Testament, believe is never just intellectual assent to something. It's never just saying, I believe that. It's always, in every case, it's always about a commitment. It's always about a trust. It's always about being so committed to what it is that you believe in that your life changes. And you trust and obey in the case we're talking about. It's Jesus. That is, on one hand, so simple. Trust, obey. Jesus, the bread of life. And remember, hunger or thirst again. But in one way or another, I think most of us, probably all of us, have tried to live that out. And we find out it's not quite as easy to do as it sounds. It's not as easy to do as it is to say. And it doesn't happen overnight. How do you learn to trust Jesus? Go to Sunday school class and they say, you can trust the Lord. Okay. We're going to go trust the Lord. You learn to trust Jesus by trusting Jesus, by walking with Him, by listening to the voice of His Spirit, by following the path that He led, that He called you to follow. That's the first thing He asked disciples to do, is follow me. Walk the path that I walk. So it's a lot different than what they think it is. And why bread? Why is this about bread? You know, unless there's a blizzard or a tropical storm or a pandemic-induced lockdown on the way, we hardly pay any attention to bread at all. by the store and pick up a loaf of bread on the way home, will you? Gotta go get some bread. Go in the grocery store, there's shelves and shelves and shelves of bread, all kinds of bread. It's everywhere, and it's just such a simple thing for us. We go in the store, we pick up a loaf of bread, we don't even pay attention to the fact that the packaging in which that loaf of bread comes costs more than the wheat that is the basis of the bread itself. There are parts of the world, many parts of the world, even today, that understand the real value of bread. That understand it is the basis of life. It's one of the very first things that human beings ever prepared, but we got to a place where we can do that. And it's been around ever since, and it's just basic to life. It's why we talk about breaking bread together. It's about why life is just so basic. It's why in the Lord's Supper and the Lord's Prayer we prayed earlier, that one of the things we ask for is our daily bread. It's just that basic. Not to us, but to the larger world, and certainly to Jesus' day. Bread was at the center of everything. And waiting to be magically wowed is so much easier than to dig deep to discern what it is about this bread. What is it that Jesus is asking us to do? See, we're kind of addicted to fast food. Grab and eat on the go. Don't think about it. Just, you know, drive to McDonald's, get what you want, be on your way. But in other cultures, including New Testament culture, meals were important. They were a gathering and a sharing. It used to be important with us. My grandchildren don't understand at all when I tell them that every night we sat down as a family around a dinner table, we had dinner together. Did my mother work, which she did, and some evenings she worked. My dad prepared the meal. We sat down and we ate it together. And you didn't miss it. Not because we were told we had to be there, nothing bad would happen. But because that was a special time for all of us. And this fast food is this grab-and-go philosophy carries over into our spiritual lives. You know, we'll be like those ancient Hebrews. We'll grab our manna for the day, and we'll worry about tomorrow when it gets there. And Jesus is trying to slow us down and say, wait a minute. You don't need the manna that's going to be gone at the end of the day. What you need is bread of life. That will give you life and be there for you and with you every day. It's the first Sunday of the month. That means what? What's up? So the first day of every month we come in here and we have bread. It's not really bread. But we call it bread. And we have wine, and it's not really wine, but we call it. Because that's what they used back when Jesus instituted this. But our grab-and-go culture brings us so often where we have communion is tacked on at the end of a worship service. It's like, well, we're finished with our worship service now, but before we go, you have to come and get your kitchen. Instead, this morning, we structured this to come to the end of this service, not with a sermon, but with the gathering at this table. to gather around the Lord's table and sharing together this wonderful gift that has been given to us. David Lowe suggested that one of the hardest things for all of us to accept about communion is that at this table, we encounter the totally unexpected, shocking, unforeseen gift of God's very own self to each of us. When Jesus says, take me, this is my body. Drink, this is my blood that's been shed for you. And by taking and drinking, we take into ourselves God's very own self. Listen to that again. One of the hardest things for all of us to accept about communion, and we usually don't even think about it, much less try to accept it, but to accept about communion is that at this table, because it's the Lord's table, because it's the table of the bread of life, we encounter the totally unexpected, shocking, unforeseen gift of God's very own self. Is that amazing? Who's going to settle for a chunk of manna? We come to this table in our grab and go mode, and we miss what we've got. So today we're taking a moment to focus on what's happening here. And I hope you remember it every other time we come to this table. It's not just a grab and go. It's coming to the table, putting our feet under the table with Jesus and being given this amazing, incredible, shocking, surprising, awesome gift of God's very own self. Be a part of us. And to go with us to the days of my life. Come on, story. Come on, allow our eyes to see and our ears to hear gift of God's own self as we receive the bread. Our Lord, Jesus the Christ, the bread of life, invites you to come and sit at this table with him. You can be yourself here. See, the host already knows all there is to know about you. And he loves and invites you here anyway. You don't need to put on airs. You don't need to dress up to look a certain way. You don't have to say certain words. All you have to do is to come and be open to what God wants to do through this thing. So come. Come in joy, come in expectation. I want all of us to take a moment and just go into that place in our hearts, in our lives, where God's Spirit abides. Get in touch with Him. And as we go through these next minutes, as we hold in our hands broken body of our Lord, and then take that into us, that we're aware of what we're doing, and then incredible gift, that simple act is for us. Push it by your heads, and in quietness of this moment, this holy moment, let God speak to you about what's about to happen in this place. Lord, grant a life of this place, this moment. Long time ago, we gathered with the disciples in another room. Took that time in the lots. Gathered all about them with storm clouds. Indeed, even the disciples who had a hard time saying anything with that understood it was a bad time. They were in trouble. There in that upper room, they celebrated together with the Passover that he meant that celebrates the deliverance of the Hebrew people. And there on the table before them was bread of that celebration and a cup. It was there that Jesus used those precious things. Shared himself with his disciples. And to tell us that every time we do that, we do it in remembrance of him. So let us be aware of what it is that's taking place. Stretch. Answer by. Except when Jesus was made something else. So there in that upper room, he took the bread. And when you give him thanks, we saw that last week, didn't we? We took the loaves and the fish and the little boy. He gave thanks. Give thanks for what he had. Look at the whole group. That's nothing. Oh, that's everything. Jesus took it. When he had given thanks, he broke it. He said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this whenever you can. It's never so good. Think about that. Think about what you just considered. Wonderful. He's the Almighty. Attached to Jesus Christ by the power of the indwelling of the Spirit, that was one of us. Incredible. Paul will later write, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your spiritual worship. Same way he took the cup. I've already said to you guys, not to think of what he did, it would reach over and take Elijah's cup and fall on the table of a Passover meal. I don't know that he did that. But I like that he did. He took that cup. And he said, this cup, this is a new covenant in my blood. To show me a new promise, a new hope, a new creation, which is yours. Do this every time that we're never sleeping. They're just consuming the whole spot. The shed lot. The rubber lot. He promised to lose on that hillside that day. But nobody took off the bridge. We never hunted. And we never did. That's his promise, each and every one of us did. Absolutely incredible. That's what David Rose was talking about. The totally unexpected, amazing gift of God's very Son. The first observance of what we have shared in 2001 later. The disciples of this old sang again and laughed. In the same way, we're going to the same bless through the time as our departing came. I bless you all. And hear the gift that you've received today. And take it with you. Because it's not man, it doesn't disappear. Thank you, as we said, bless through the time. Jesus, and the love and the power, the joy and the justice, the goodness and the mercy, the hope and the healing of God's Spirit are loose in this world through your lives. I will wish you just conclude. For go to be who you already are, and the grace and peace of Jesus be with you now and forever.